Harper Audio presents Yes and How Improvisation Reverses No But Thinking and Improves Creativity and Collaboration by Kelly Leonard and Tom Yorton. Read by Alan Winter. This book is dedicated to the founders of the Second City and the generations of artists who honor the past by staying so fiercely in the moment. Introduction. We have cool jobs. We get to work with generation after generation of some of the funniest and most creative individuals walking this planet. We work at a company that has established itself as an industry leader, and our product is filled with invention, intellect, and laughter. And sometimes we hate our jobs. Everyone does. But from our experience, we tend to hate them a lot less than other people. And we've been able to identify the core elements at play when we are happy in our work and when we are not. We are at our happiest and most successful when we are working as improvisers. When we are fiercely following the elements of improvisation, we generate ideas both quickly and efficiently. We're more engaged with our coworkers. Our interactions with clients become richer or more long-standing. We weather rough storms with more aplomb, and we don't work burdened by a fear of failure. When we are in full improviser mode, we become better leaders and better followers. Likewise, we hear things that we didn't hear before because we are listening deeply and fully in the moment. Our work and our lives are so much better when we act like improvisers. We are sure yours could be too. That's why we wanted to share our stories. That's why we wrote this book. We are not the creators of improvisational doctrine. We are not gurus. We don't lead Second City workshops or star in the productions. Yet, for years, we have been deeply involved in the Second City's efforts to help people become better at what they do by showing them how improv training can increase their capacity for innovation, their creativity, and their confidence. We are two people with vastly different professional backgrounds, and yet, independent of each other, we have witnessed enough at the Second City to arrive at identical conclusions. This stuff works, and this stuff works across myriad platforms. Kelly grew up at the Second City washing dishes and seating audience members when Mike Myers and Bonnie Hunt were virtual unknowns starring on stage in Chicago in the late 1980s. Although he thought he was working at the Second City as a way station prior to becoming a world-famous playwright, David Mamet held the same job at Second City some two decades before him, it turns out that he was something of an entrepreneur. When he moved to the box office in 1990, he pushed through a number of changes to better market the productions and improve customer service, despite an institutional reluctance to change anything. Promoted to associate producer of the Second City in 1992 at the ripe age of 26, he sought out new talent for this world-famous theater that had been experiencing a fair amount of criticism for artistic irrelevance. That fresh talent base included such young, unknown comic actor writers as Stephen Colbert, Steve Carell, and Tina Fey. In 2001, he assumed the title of Executive Vice President of the Second City, where he devised new artistic and business opportunities with companies such as Norwegian Cruise Line, develop partnerships with regional theaters across America to create original comedy plays, and forged alliances with Lyric Opera Chicago and Hubbard Street Dance to generate hybrid commercial artistic events. Tom is an advertising and marketing guy by trade who worked in ad agencies and client-side marketing positions before joining the Second City in early 2002. Always creatively overqualified for the jobs he let himself take, Tom jumped at the chance to run Second City Communications, now called Second City Works. Back then, he won the beauty contest because the plan was to turn SCC into an ad agency. But we figured out how to be an agency of a different kind, one that did more than an ad agency by finding innovative applications for the Second City's core competencies of short-form comedy and improvisation. More on that throughout the audio program. But suffice it to say that Tom still gets to do what he's always done, find ways to win over audiences. He just uses a different toolkit to do it. We decided to write this book together when we could no longer ignore the overwhelming evidence that our work was not only revolutionary, but that the revolution was already on its way. We wrote this introduction on February 23, 2014, the same day that the New York Times published an article by Thomas Friedman about the qualities that Google looks for when hiring, which include the ability to process on the fly, a willingness to relinquish power, ease with creating space for others to contribute, and individuals who can learn how to learn from failure. Those are the qualities of an improviser, and they can be learned. It is common knowledge that diet and exercise are keys to staying physically healthy, but practicing improvisation is like yoga for your professional development. A solid, strengthening workout that improves emotional intelligence, teaches you to pivot out of tight and uncomfortable spaces, and helps you become both a more compelling leader and a more collaborative follower. Even better, these qualities are fully transferable to your life outside the office. The benefits of improvisation can extend to your personal relationships, whether with your partner, your family, or your friends. Anne Libera, former artistic director of the Second City Training Center, used to lead each orientation for beginning improv students with the same words. This work will change your life. It has certainly changed ours for the better, and based on the stories we hear from thousands of professional clients who credit their improv skills with helping them build effective teams, break down silos, foster creativity, and spark innovation, we're confident it can change yours too. So, sit back, unwrap your candy, turn off your cell phone, and please refrain from taking photographs or making recordings of any kind. We take you now to a resort overlooking the Potomac River. Chapter 1. The Business of Funny. The Lansdowne Conference Center in Leesburg, Virginia, is a fine place to hold a business meeting, but located in the D.C. area wine country with a hotel-style glass and brick facade and two championship golf courses, nobody would ever confuse it with a mecca for comedy. Yet every January for the past 13 years, Lansdowne has rocked with laughter brought on by actors from the Second City who come to Virginia for an unlikely reason: to help about 100 Major League Baseball rookies adapt to the unusual challenges of life in the bigs. These challenges are wide-ranging and quite foreign to mere mortals who can't throw or hit a 95-mile-per-hour fastball. How to deal effectively with veterans in the clubhouse and the rapacious media hordes. how to manage a newfound fortune when you grew up poor, how to find work-life balance when there is none, and how to navigate the perils of performance-enhancing drugs, aggressive autograph seekers, and the influence of organized crime in sports. Typical stuff for professional athletes, but not the typical fodder of comedy. But Major League Baseball and the Major League Baseball Players Association know their audience. Mostly guys around 20 years old, brimming with swag and testosterone. And because they know them well, they know that lectures and classroom finger-wagging aren't effective ways to teach the vital life skills that will allow the rookies to have long and productive careers on the field. So, they made the unlikely choice to bring in Second City talent who, over the course of 4 days, perform custom-written comedy vignettes based on real-world baseball situations, facilitate productive conversations around those vignettes with Second City alum and clinical psychologist Dr. Kate Porterfield, teach improv-based communication skills, and in general, win over a tough audience of ballplayers who will be better equipped to protect their careers because of the time they've spent with a bunch of comedians and improv instructors. While our work at this conference is fun and funny, we're not brought in for mere entertainment. We're called on to bring serious topics to life through comedy, to get young athletes engaged, and to give them some important communication skills that will help them cope with circumstances few of us could ever truly understand. They do this because what the Second City knows and what Major League Baseball has learned is that the individual who is armed with an improvisational toolkit has an instantaneous advantage in dealing with all manner of difficult situations that naturally arise in the course of one's career. When, for instance, a long-lost third cousin once removed comes calling for a loan to start a deli vinyl record shop, the young ball player will have learned improv skills to both disarm and deflect the advance. The same set of tools will give you to turn around difficult employees and disgruntled customers. Improvisation, at its most basic level, lets you respond more quickly in real time, and when practiced, also allows you to use comic relief to ease a potentially awkward confrontation. Make 'em laugh. Make 'em think. A winning formula not only for baseball rookies, but for education reformers, cruise line directors, and the millions of other professionals whom Second City has reached over the past 3 decades by reformulating venerable theater teaching methods into cutting-edge business training programs for the 21st century. We're not merely offering an improved communication tool either. We've introduced a whole new skill set for invention and innovation that has been proven to unlock the creative forces of individuals and teams and make it easier for them to test those creative ideas and launch them in the marketplace. The more the Second City works with folks from the business world, the more we have come to understand that despite all the planning, processes, controls, and governance, business is one big act of improvisation. For anyone who has spent time working in or running a business, you know that a great deal of your time and energy go to dealing with the unplanned and the unexpected, with the curveballs and gray zones that typify corporate life. This audio program is for you, to help you build the toolkit you'll need to deal with that challenging reality. Setting the scene. Maybe we're not brothers from another mother, but our comedy troupe and the businesses we work with have a lot of the same needs and priorities. We both work in teams that have to adapt to change and new information under high pressure and rapidly changing circumstances. Just as businesses must create and innovate or die, so must we, every night on the stage. We are both ultimately accountable to the audiences we serve. Like our corporate clients, we must find and develop new talent to make sure our business grows and stays vibrant over time. We face silos separating departments that would benefit greatly from a higher degree of interaction and collaboration. When sales goals aren't being reached, or the competition steals away a client, or that new product launch lands like a lead balloon, we are just as likely as others to drop our best practices and work out of fear. The list goes on, to the surprise of many.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.